campus. And then Elaine Boggs and son Zach are here from Dandridge, Tennessee, looking at the trade school. Raise your hand if you don't mind. We're thrilled Zach's here today. Praying God will lead him and guide him. This is the season for lots of guests to be on campus. And so be sure to make yourself a welcoming committee and encourage them. We're looking forward to a great day. This is Friday. Friday's always a good day. Tonight we kick off the 119s for Teens for Christ crusade. We were supposed to have it last night and tonight. Had to cancel last night because of road conditions in some places. We're looking forward to the meeting tonight. Praying God will meet with us in a big way. And Brother Otis is here to preach this morning. So that's always good. I want you to pray for him. Well, Stephen's going to come and lead us. Let's sing this hymn with all of our heart. All right?
Sing it out. Oh, how I love Jesus. There is a name.
For prayer, we need to remember a young man, Glenn Savage, his prospective student and having some health issues we need to pray for, and pray you remember him in your prayers. Also for our Teens for Christ meeting tonight, please be much in prayer for that. That God will work in hearts and bless the young people that are there, and also be with the speaker and direct him. Continue to pray for Pastor, of course, and our ministry weekend coming up. Praying that God will use each of us during that time. And, of course, pray for Brother Duhart as he comes to speak to us. Let's pray. Father, we are thankful for your love and blessings in our lives, Lord, for this time that we can bow before you, Lord, and bring our needs, our burdens, our cares to thee. And lift these requests here also up to thee, knowing that you hear and answer prayer. We're thankful for that, Father, for this young man, Glenn Savage, Lord, we pray that you'll work in his life, touch his body, Lord, and meet this need in his life and direct in every aspect of this. And Lord, may you raise him up and meet that need that he has. Lord, for the ministry weekend, we lift this up to thee, that you'll bless and help the young people, Lord, to plan to be a blessing and encouragement to many people during that time and use their talents to honor and glorify Christ. Pray, Father, for our Teens for Christ crusade tonight, that you'll bless in it, save souls, work in young people's lives, and challenge them to give their heart and life to thee. Bless our speaker during that time. Also for Pastor, we continue to lift him up, that you'll bring him to full recovery. Just encourage him through this time, and Lord, just work in his life, and may we support him and pray for him as we should. Bless our speaker, Brother Otis Duhart, as he comes. Lord, encourage him, just fill him with thy spirit. And help us, Lord, to open our hearts and minds to thee as you speak to us today. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Pray for Hannah Butler this morning as she plays We Shall Behold Him.
Thank you, Hannah. Appreciate that. Here are the announcements for today. Just a reminder, as Brother Paulie said, that Mr. Chris Chavez from the Hoosier Hills Baptist Camp is here, and he's outside the bookstore area with the display table there, and I want to encourage many of you to go by and talk to him about working at camp this summer, and we love and appreciate the camp there and hope many of you can help them out. Also, all of our students are encouraged that you're invited to the Teens for Christ Crusade tonight. It's at 6:30, the rally time at 6:30 there at Central High School Auditorium. And, of course, plenty of time to eat supper here and then get over there for that meeting. And I want to encourage many of you to do that. Also, any student who has attended Crown UK in the past or would like to in the future, we're encouraging especially you to attend the new building dedication. It's on Saturday morning in the Curtis Hudson Center at 9:45, and we're going to join them in England via Skype. And actually, all of our students are invited to attend. If you're not already doing some ministry at that particular time, all are invited, but especially all of our students who've been to Crown UK or who are intending to go to Crown UK. I know this will be especially helpful to you to see the new properties there. And that building dedication, if you'll meet at 9:45 in the Curtis Hudson Center, we'll all be there, and we'll start promptly at 10 o'clock.
and join in with them in England for that, and we're really excited about that, and I know many of you will be excited to see the campus there. We have about 16 or so of our own students who are studying there this semester, and they'll be in the building dedication ceremony there, so you'll be able to see all them via Skype as well, and we're excited about that. Dr. Brian Green will be there, and of course, Pastor will be speaking as well. This Saturday, we are just a reminder, our student activity is indoor soccer and ice skating at the Icearium, and shuttles are leaving at 7 p.m. from the Student Activity Center, and you need to sign up by today if you haven't already signed up for that, and a recreational dress is appropriate for that, and again, that's 7 p.m. on Saturday, and I hope many of you could take advantage of that activity. And then just a couple reminders looking ahead. Don't forget on Saturday night to spring forward 1 hour. If you don't, you'll be a wrong time for Sunday school. I know that. I can't remember how that works out. But anyhow, I think you'll be late an hour, all right? So spring forward an hour before you go to bed Saturday night and be on time for the Lord's Day. Don't forget next Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we have white glove in the dorms. And so if you're a dorm student, see your RA. And then thirdly, looking ahead to the ministry break, it begins on Thursday, next Thursday, March the 12th, extends through Tuesday the 17th. And as Brother Paulie mentioned, you're letting us know through the form that you got where you're going to be serving the Lord during that time. But if you're traveling just in your own vehicle to your own home, you do not need a pass. But if you're traveling with someone else or traveling somewhere besides your own home, you do need to secure a pass from the Dean of Students Office, and we want you to do that as soon as you possibly can. So please be sure to make that happen by having your parents call and filling out the form. The passes are in the student services room, and they're asked to please be submitted before Wednesday of next week so there's time to process them. And then a special announcement from the concerning New Testament pioneers. This is the time right now to define what you're going to do for the summer and to really begin to plan for that. And we want you to know that Brother Tim Cart is helping coordinate all of our New Testament pioneer work during the summer. And his office, we call him the Global Gospel Initiative Office, is located in the Curtis Hudson Center on the other campus. And if you would like to travel this summer as with New Testament Pioneers, that may be the entire summer or part of the summer. If you'd like to travel and be involved in some mission work, we want you to let us know. Some of you have an area targeted that you would like to go to right now, and we can help you get there, okay? Others of you are looking for areas. We have many different opportunities open. We have some of the key areas that we have sort of on target right now. We have opportunities open to go to China, to go to Brazil, to teach English and do missionary work in Honduras during the summer. We have some church planting opportunities down in South Florida among English speakers and Hispanics. We have some church planting and camp opportunities in Texas, especially among Hispanic groups there. So those are just some key areas that we have now. Others are developing, and some of you have an area that you already want to go to, and we can help you get there. And we can help you learn how to raise the funds and gain support, and some of you need to partner with another student. That would just enhance what you want to do. And we want to encourage you to do that. So stop by the office of Brother Tim Cart and let him know of what your intention is or what your interest is. And he wants to get a record of that, and we'd like to send you out as a New Testament Church Pioneer this summer. And we already have a number of young people going out, and it's not too late, but we want you to start now. You need enough headway from now on to be able to prepare and plan for that, for it to be something great. So keep that in mind. I want to encourage you to stop by his office as soon as possible to sign up for that. Today is Mrs. Christy Sexton's birthday, so happy birthday to her. And tomorrow is Mr. Curtis Bixler's birthday. Curtis is in the back. Happy birthday to both these folks. Brother Scott is going to come back now and lead us in a chorus.
All right, stand up with me. We're going to sing this chorus, Christ for Me. Yes, it's Christ for Me. He's my Savior, my Lord and King. It's a great chorus. Let's sing this out together. Christ for me. Yes, it's Christ for me. He's my Savior. Let's try that one together. That's a great note to end on. All right, let's try it again. Get up there and hit it now. Here we go. Christ for me. Yes, it's Christ for me. He's my Savior, my Lord and King. I'm so happy I shout and sing. Christ for me. Yes, it's Christ for me. Every day as I go,
some of you hit it. God bless you for it. When I hear these choruses, I always think of Dr. Reese. Amen. And when you think of him, I want you to keep praying for him in these days. He's home from the hospital. Thank God for that. Continue to pray. Now, I want to take care of just a couple of things while this quartet comes along and prepares to sing. I want you to take this form out that you received coming into chapel today regarding the student ministry break. And we're very excited about this because one thing you're most excited about is you get a break. That's good. But we're adding the ministry part to it because, look, we think that everywhere you go, you ought to be seeking to be a blessing and to help other people. Next Wednesday, which is the chapel just before this break, we will go through a few things and give you some instruction. But we're trying to see now where you're going to be, how many different churches. And so I want you now, if you've not done this already, to take a moment and fill this out. If you say, well, I'm not going anywhere, then I still want you to fill it out. Put your name on it and tell me that you're staying in the area because it may be that we need some additional help here ministry-wise over the weekend while others are away, and we'll know that we could call on you. So I want every student in the student body to fill this form out. So if you'll do that for me right now, please. And then we've given you places for you to fill out either your home church. How many of you are going home? Good. How many of you are going to someone else's home or to another church? Would you raise your hand? Good. So it's designated so that we know where you're going. If you're going to more than one place, you can use both of these places. And then tell us what you're doing. Where it says ministry, that's for you to tell us, I'm preaching, I'm singing, I'm giving a testimony, working with young people, leading in silent prayer, whatever it is that you're doing while you're there. Some of you are not awake this morning, are you? What I'm after is this. You don't just show up, all right? You don't just show up. You plan, you prepare, you call ahead. If I were a pastor, I would want to know that you were going to be in the services with me on this particular Lord's Day so that I could use you in some way and we could hear from you. But they're not going to do that if they don't know. Some of you get a little embarrassed about this, but I'm going to require that all of you that are traveling and you're going to be at another church other than this one, you must call the pastor or the youth director, whoever is the contact person for you there, and let them know that you're coming and try to work out something. Now, they may not ask you to preach, but you can volunteer to serve. Now, if they ask you to do something in a public way, that's great. But if they don't, you should say to them, well, look, while I'm there, I'd love to be a part. Could I come go soul winning on Saturday with you? Or could I help in a children's class on Sunday? What can I do to help? Make yourself available. And I want to tell you that we'll have another form similar to this that you'll fill out when you return where you'll report on what you did and what God did. And so let's make it a real matter of prayer. Let's ask the Lord to use us. We're usually in a couple hundred churches at least. And that's exciting that we can have that kind of influence and encourage preachers and people. So fill this out. We'll collect it at the end of the meeting. We look forward to that. Brother Otis Duhart's preaching for us today. I love Brother Otis. He's an evangelist. And, of course, when he first started traveling and preaching, his claim to fame was that he'd played on Bobby Bowden's national championship football team and was a football player that had gotten saved and God had changed his life. But when I think of Brother Otis now, I don't think of a football player, I think of a preacher because he has a message from the Lord, something to say and the touch of God upon him. And a pastor wanted him to preach in the chapel hour and I'm excited about it. I want you to pray that God will use him to speak to your heart. Get your Bible out and pray for him. Just before he comes, this quartet's coming to sing. Not the Half Has Been Told.
Express the kingdom that's to come. The mind of man cannot conceive the preparation that's been done. We speak in terms we understand to uncover the glory there, but soon with eyes that clearly see
half has been told, a small part, not the whole. It's beyond imagination what's in store. Soon our eyes shall behold gates of pearl, streets of gold. But there's more, not the half has been told.
Not a legend or a myth, this grand and glorious place. We barely touched the hem of it, and already we're amazed.
But what is that to what's to come in the presence of our God? For now we can but wonder, but soon we'll stand in awe. Not the half has been told, a small part, not the whole. It's beyond imagination what's in store. Soon our eyes shall behold gates of pearl, streets of gold. But there's more, not the half has been told. Eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, nor entered into the heart of man. All that God hath prepared for those who love Him. Not the half has been told, a small part, not the whole. It's beyond imagination what's in store. Soon our eyes shall behold gates of pearl, streets of gold. But there's more, not the half has been told. But there's more, not the half has been told.
Amen. Well, good morning. Well, I appreciate the 10 of you that responded to me on that. It truly is a blessing to be here this morning, and certainly I want to thank God for the opportunity. Thank God for Pastor Sexton and the Crown College staff and their faithfulness, and certainly, again, it's just an honor and a privilege for me to have this opportunity, and I hope that you are doing just fine in spite of what I hear to be a grueling week of midterms. And I asked one young man, how did he do? He said, I passed. Boy, it sounded like he barely made it, but I ain't gonna call him out, but that's okay. It's better to pass than fail in that sense. Amen. I don't want to prolong the chapel service this morning. If you have your Bibles, I actually turn with me to the Old Testament book of 1 Kings, chapter number 12. 1 Kings, chapter number 12, and we'll begin reading at verse number 25 in just a moment. 1 Kings chapter 12, we'll begin reading at verse number 25 in just a moment. After the kingdom of Israel was divided, the first king to rule over the 10 tribes or the northern kingdom was Jeroboam. And from the start of his reign, Jeroboam quickly proved to be an evil king, for he sinned and caused Israel to sin. And the Bible says in 1 Kings chapter 12, beginning at verse number 25, then Jeroboam built Shechem and Mount Ephraim and dwelt therein and went out from this and built Penuel. And Jeroboam said in his heart, now shall the kingdom return to the house of David. If this people go up to sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah. Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem, Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt, and he set the one in Bethel, and the other put he in Dan. Look with me again at verse number 28 in this chapter. In 1 Kings chapter 12, at the very heart of verse number 28, Jeroboam said, behold thy gods. Behold thy gods. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I do thank you for this time. God, thank you for this opportunity. And Lord, we thank you for this great, Lord, institution, dear God. Thank you for the part that you've, Lord, given me in this. And Lord, how I've been helped in this place, dear God. And thank you for this precious opportunity to stand and to preach thy word, dear God. And Lord, as I examine my own abilities, dear God, I know that I'm inadequate. I don't have it. But you do. God, I pray that by your spirit you would strengthen me even now. Lord, speak to me, through me, to us, dear God. Help us to be attentive to thy word in this hour. Speak to our hearts. Lord, have your will and way. And when the last amen is said, may we be careful to give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory, and which thou art so worthy of. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray, amen and amen. In many cases, using a substitute is highly acceptable. For example, it is acceptable for coaches to substitute their players during ball games. It is acceptable for diabetics to use sugar substitutes like Splenda to help them achieve a healthy blood sugar level. It is acceptable for instructors to use substitute teachers in their absence in most educational settings. It is acceptable for pastors to use other preachers as substitutes to fill the pulpit from time to time. But when it comes to the object of worship, there is never an acceptable substitute for the true and living God. Quite frankly, the only substitute for God is God. Some of y'all will get that after a while. It seemed like from this side right here over to there was enough of you that got it. But some of you over there still hung over from midterm. So I'm going to say that again because that's a good place to say amen. Quite frankly, the only acceptable substitute for God is God. Amen. Amen. I ain't got no money. I can't buy no amen. So if you got one, give it to me. The only acceptable substitute for God is God. Yet in our society, people are substituting the God of the Bible with their own idea of who they think God is. God is being redefined and presented as a God who is less judgmental. He's being presented as a God who is more tolerable and more acceptable of the sinful lifestyle that sinful man is desiring to live. And because of that, scores of people are flocking to churches, and in their hearts, they're believing that they're worshiping the true and living God, but what they're doing is nothing short of worshiping idols. They're worshiping man's idea of who they think God is, which has nothing to do with the Bible. Therefore, there's a great need for a revival of true worship. Amen. In our day. Now, as we turn our attention to the reign of Jeroboam, we'll quickly discover that the great sin of Jeroboam was idolatry. Prior to his reign, God promised Jeroboam to give him Israel if Jeroboam would simply obey the commandments of the Lord. As a matter of fact, look with me at 1 Kings chapter number 11. Let's look at verse number 37 and 38 as we continue the introduction. The Bible says in 1 Kings 11, 37 and 38, we'll see the promise that God made to Jeroboam as the prophet is speaking to him here. The Bible says in verse 37, "And I will take thee," this is the prophet speaking on behalf of God to Jeroboam, "and thou shalt reign according to all that thy soul desireth, and shall be king over Israel." Look at verse 38. Here's the promise. "And it shall be, if thou wilt hearken unto all that I command thee, and wilt walk in my ways, and do that is right in my sight, to keep my statutes and my commandments, as David my servant did, that I will be with thee, and build thee a sure house, as I built for David," get this, "and will give Israel unto thee." In no uncertain terms, God promised Jeroboam that if he would do right, if he would obey God, God said, "I will give you Israel." But Jeroboam took matters into his own hands in fear of losing the people and ultimately the kingdom. Jeroboam came up with his own religious system. He created idol gods, and he used those idol gods as a substitute for the Lord God, Jehovah, and he plunged the northern kingdom of Israel into idolatry, which led to the destruction of his kingdom. Now, as we take a closer look at this particular passage of scripture, as we turn back to chapter 12, may the Spirit of God strengthen our desire, strengthen our commitment to be true worshipers of the Lord Jesus Christ, and give us the boldness to cry out against idol worship in the word of the Lord. As we begin, notice first of all the mind of Jeroboam. The mind of Jeroboam. In 1 Kings chapter 12, look with me at verse number 26 and 27 together. The Bible says, "And Jeroboam said in his heart," that word heart, if you look it up, it speaks of the inner man. It speaks of what I believe is the mind of Jeroboam. "Now shall the kingdom return to the house of David. If this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah." So here we find, as we think about the mind of Jeroboam, the Spirit of God takes us inside his mind and allows us to see what King Jeroboam was consciously thinking concerning the northern kingdom of Israel. Can I tell you? Jeroboam feared that if the people were allowed to take the annual trip to Jerusalem to offer sacrifice in the temple, Jeroboam feared that he would lose the people. He was afraid that he was going to lose the kingdom. He was afraid that the people was going to want to reunite with Rehoboam, king of Judah. Not only do we see that he was afraid of losing the people, notice what else was going on in his mind. Let's look at verse number 27 again. "If this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah." Watch this. "And they shall" what? "Kill me." Kill me. Hey, Jeroboam wasn't just afraid of losing the people. Jeroboam was afraid of losing his own life. He thought that, hey, there would come a time where the people would want me to lead them. They would want to go back to Rehoboam, king of Judah. And not only that, they're going to kill me. He was afraid of losing the kingdom. He was afraid of losing his life. I think it would be safe to say that Jeroboam was a man who felt like he had no job security. Jeroboam was a man who felt like he can get fired at any time. And this is what was going on in his mind. You say, hey, what we ought to take from this? Here it is, simply stated. There are men. There are religious leaders, might I add, who live in fear of losing the people that they've been given to lead. Watch this. And although they will not admit it, this is what's going on in their minds. Let me ask you a question. Do you believe that there are pastors who are afraid of losing the people? Do you believe that there are pastors that are afraid of losing the church that they pastor? They're afraid that, no, they might not kill them, but one day I'm going to walk in there and these people going to force me to resign. Some of you young men are here. I've talked to you. I know you. We rub shoulders. God has called you to pastor. Listen, don't succumb to the temptation of doing your own thing in fear of losing people, in fear of losing the church. Let me get a little closer to home. Jeroboam was like the college boyfriend who was afraid that he was going to lose his girlfriend when she went back home. Now that side woke up and this side done got quiet. Did y'all get that? Honey, don't go. You know your ex-boyfriend back at that church that you came from, and I don't want you to go. That's just me meddling, that's all. I'm trying to make it relevant. He was afraid of losing the people. And I'm going to tell you something. As I said it once, I'll say it again. There are pastors, leaders, that are afraid of losing the people, losing the church. And this is what we find that was going on in the mind of Jeroboam. But before we move on, let me just ask a simple question. How could Jeroboam have lost the people if they were going to worship the true and living God? Hey, the best thing for the people is God. You got that? How was he going to lose them if they were wholeheartedly given to worshiping the Lord God Jehovah? Listen, if you're a faithful pastor and you're following the Lord, you don't have to worry about whether or not people who are truly following the Lord following you. It'll happen. It'll happen. Yet Jeroboam had some mental issues. See, I was watching the news the other day, and I don't know, I was watching this one particular channel, and the guy that was speaking, he had a model of a brain. And you know what he said? He said, oftentimes, we don't consider this bodily organ as an organ that can get sick. But watch this. There are more people that got mental issues than they care to admit. Jeroboam had a mental problem. Hey, Jeroboam was an insecure man. He was afraid of losing the people. Man, I know y'all some intelligent people, and I know y'all got point number one, the mind of Jeroboam. But not only do we see the mind of Jeroboam, let me give you a second thing. Notice, secondly, the making of a man-made religion. The making of a man-made religion. 1 Kings chapter 12, look at verse number 28. So obviously this is the solution that Jeroboam came up with. Wherefore, the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, watch this, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. So here we find that Jeroboam made two calves of gold and he presented them to the people of Israel, watch this now, as a substitute for the Lord God Jehovah and as their new object of worship. He didn't necessarily try to do away with God. He just made his own gods and presented them to the people as their new object of worship. He created a man-made religion. Jeroboam didn't want nothing to do with the old-time religion, as they say. He had his own thing. He did his own thing. And I'm going to tell you something. By doing so, he plunged the northern kingdom into idolatry. He did this, as I said, to keep the people from going to Jerusalem. But think about it. Jerusalem was God's choice. Jerusalem was the place where God had put his name. Jerusalem was the place where God's people were to come and offer sacrifice and to worship him in the temple. Yet Jeroboam sought to keep the people from going to Jerusalem. He sought to keep the people from going to the house of the Lord. And I'm going to tell you something. The reason there's such idol worship going on in our day is because of the great neglect of the house of God. Amen. Jeroboam, he created a man-made religion. And let me give you three things at this point. Number one, notice he set up new worship centers in 1 Kings chapter 12. Look at verse 29 and 30. The Bible says that he set the one in Bethel. By the way, Bethel means house of God. This historic place where the patriarchs of old had met with God. And the other put he in Dan. Look at verse 30. The Bible says, and this thing became a sin, for the people went up to worship before the one, even unto Dan. So here we find that Jeroboam set up these new worship centers. He set up these new sanctuaries, one in Bethel and the other one, if you look at the map, way up there in Dan. I mean, it was about 100 miles away from the northern kingdom, or 100 miles north in the north of the northern kingdom. Yet he set up these sanctuaries. He set up these new worship centers. In other words, he set up these new illegitimate churches. And I'm going to tell you something. There's a whole lot of illegitimate churches rising up right here in America. And he set up these illegitimate worship centers. And what surprised me is how quickly God's people turned from the worship of the true and living God to worship these idols. They quickly turned. They quickly turn. Don't get so beside yourself that you don't think you can turn away from worshiping the true and living God. Some of you might need to be careful going home. Perhaps you came out of one of those rock and roll centers. I don't know. I'm sure meddling now. But whatever the case may be, we ought to stand guard that we not get reeled in to some place where they're calling it worship. But all it is an idol worship service. Jeroboam created new worship centers. And the people went to worship these idols contrary to the second commandment in Exodus. I won't have you turn there, but just make note of it. In Exodus chapter 20, verses 4 and 5, God told the people, he commanded the people, hey, don't make no graven images. Don't make no things in the likeness of heaven or on earth to worship, to serve. Don't make nothing to take my place. Beware of substituting me for anybody or anything. Yet Jeroboam, trying to secure his reign, trying to secure the control of the people, and obviously he knew something about the people. He knew that if he came up with this man-made religion, they were going to follow it hook, line, and sinker. And they went. They went and worshiped at these new worship centers. Not only did he set up new worship centers, let me give you a second thing. He set up high places and his own priesthood. 1 Kings chapter 12, look at verse number 31. The Bible says, and he made an house of high places, or a house of altars, and made, watch this, priests of the lowest of the people, which were not of the sons of Levi. So here, Jeroboam built altars and appointed priests from outside the tribe of Levi, which were more than likely non-compliant to Jeroboam's, watch this, man-made religion. And so he had to set up his own priesthood. People, watch this, who by and large bought in to his new approach to worship. Can I tell you something? For those of us who know the true and living God and desire to be true worshipers of the Lord Jesus Christ, we ought not go for any alternate form of worship that would be set up to take the place of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jeroboam created his own high places. He set up his own priesthood. Anybody that had a message, Jeroboam said, y'all come on. Y'all come on. In other words, let me try to make that relevant. he was letting anybody in the pulpit. Yeah, not just men, but women. Women were allowed to go and shout their weave out. You don't believe me? That church is like that. That church is like that. Soon as somebody walked through the door, oh, here go prophetess so-and-so, come on up here. It's on you. Yeah, that's what was going on. He was consecrating anybody. He was letting anybody stand in place of the priesthood. He set up high places and his own priesthood. But not only that, he set up a new annual feast. 1 Kings chapter 12, look at verse 32 and 33. The Bible says, and Jeroboam ordained a feast in the eighth month on the 15th day of the month. Watch that next word. What's that next word? Like. Hey, he was a copycat. Jeroboam was an industrious young man. He worked hard. He was smart. And so what he did was he copied. I hope some of y'all on the midterm were sitting over there copying your neighbor. I'm going to circle B just like she did. A couple of y'all getting that. Some of y'all, well, I'm telling you. Y'all leave me hanging now. But notice, the fifth day of the month, watch this, like a counterfeit, like unto the feast that is in Judah, and he offered upon the altar as if he was a high priest. So did he in Bethel, sacrificing unto the calves that he had made, and he placed in Bethel the priests of the high places which he had made. Verse 33, so he offered upon the altar which he had made, notice that word made keep coming up, in Bethel the 15th day of the eighth month, even in the month which he had devised in his own heart. Hey, this wasn't something that God had given him. This was something Jeroboam came up with from his own sinful heart. And ordained a feast unto the children of Israel. And he offered upon the altar and burnt incense. Get this. Jeroboam imitated the great feast of tabernacles that God had set up for the people of Israel to give thanks unto him and praise God for his goodness to him. He imitated that feast. He imitated the Feast of Tabernacles in Judah, and he changed the date of the feast from the seventh month to the eighth month, watch this, for the convenience of the people. You know anything about the Jews? They were farmers. And so what Jeroboam did, watch this, to accommodate the people. And I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of churches that are doing this, that, and the other to accommodate the people. And they're getting farther and farther away from worshiping the true and living God. So to accommodate the people, he changed the day. I'm going to give y'all an extra month to take care of your crop. And then when all that's done, y'all come on down here and let's get our praise on. Yeah. No, I like you ain't familiar with them terms. You done heard that before. Yeah. You say, what's this got to do with anything? I've tried to say it before, but let me say it again. Man-made religions are being propagated by churches all over the world. And people are conveniently being led astray from worshiping the true and living God, and they're being plunged headlong into idol worship. People are not worshiping God. They're worshiping man's idea of who God is. You don't believe me? I tried to get a visual of what this looked like, and I hope I'm not violating anything. But you go on YouTube, and I just happen to be trying to, you know, I put in YouTube the rock band church. There's this one particular church called LCBC. I never heard of it until I looked it up last night. And thousands of people. I'm talking about tens and thousands of people are flocking to this place. They got so many people coming on Saturday and Sunday that they're having to set up satellite churches, as they call them. And the news did a little story on them and say, what do you accredit this to? The man was like, I don't know what God is doing. We just wanted to make a church where people who don't go to church could come to church. You heard it? He said, we just wanted to make a church where people would come. And I mean, people coming in days of dukes and flip-flops on. And they up there for their worship music, if you will. They had the artist up there singing, "Do you want to build a snowman?" That's terrible. That's terrible. Appreciate the help. But it's going on right here in America. And all over the world, there are churches that are propagating their own idea of who God is. And there are people that are flocking to these places by the drove, and they're engaging in idol worship. They're engaging in a man-made religion. Number one, the mind of Jeroboam. Number two, the making of a man-made religion. There's a third and final thing I want you to note. Notice the man of God from Judah. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 13. By the way, you have to connect the two chapters to get the gist of it. Notice the man of God from Judah in 1 Kings. If I said Samuel, I apologize. 1 Kings chapter 13, look at verse 1. The Bible says, "And behold, there came a man of God out of Judah by the word of the Lord unto Bethel, and Jeroboam stood by the altar to burn incense." So watch this. While the new feast was going on, while Jeroboam was orchestrating his new man-made religion, God crashed the party. God sent a man of God there to proclaim his message to Jeroboam. We see the man of God from Judah. There are two things I want you to note. Number one, notice the saying of the man of God. 1 Kings chapter 13, look at verse 2. The Bible says, "And he cried against the altar and the word of the Lord and said," watch this, "O altar, altar, thus saith the Lord, behold, a child shall be born unto the house of David, Josiah by name, and upon thee shall he offer the priests of the high places that burn incense upon thee, and men's bones shall be burned upon thee." God sent the man of God, and the man of God predicted the birth of King Josiah, and that Josiah would take these priests that were offering these sacrifices and sacrifice them on the very altar that Jeroboam had built. And if you know the story, I won't have it turned. Now, I do have it here, just for reference sake. Don't turn. But in 2 Kings chapter 23, write it down, verse 15 to 16 and verse 20, you'll find out that after Josiah found the word of God, Josiah carried out this very prophecy of taking these priests, taking these men's bones and offering them on this altar that God sent the man of God to go and cry out against. It came to pass. God destroyed this worship system that Jeroboam had set up. We see the saying of the man of God. But notice the second thing. Notice the sign from the man of God in verse 3. The Bible says he gave a sign the same day, saying, "This is the sign which the Lord has spoken. Behold, the altar shall be rent, and the ashes that are upon it shall be poured out." Look at verse number 5. The Bible says the altar was rent. Hey, just as the man of God said it would happen, God gave proof that what he said was of him and that it would come to pass. The Bible says again in verse 5, the altar was rent and the ashes poured out from the altar according to the sign which the man of God had given by the word of the Lord. Can I tell you something? As we think about this man of God, as God's messengers, as God's people, we ought to cry against idol worship. Hey, we ought to cry against false religion in the word of the Lord. If it's right, it's right. And if it's wrong, it's wrong. And God sent a man of God to cry against the altar. And I'm going to tell you, in this day, we need courageous Christians who are not afraid stand up and cry out against the idol worship going on in our day. In efforts to keep the people from reuniting with Rehoboam, king of Judah,
Jeroboam made two golden calves for the people to worship as a substitute for the Lord God Jehovah. And it eventually led to the downfall of his kingdom. Now, whether it's golden calves or man's false ideas of who God is, we ought not let nothing or no one take the place of the Lord Jesus Christ as our object of worship. And by the grace of Almighty God, we ought to cry out against idol worship in the word of the Lord. Now, I got a little illustration. You may not know this about me. I want to be one of those preachers who know how to effectively use illustrations, but I haven't come there yet. But I'm going to try to use this illustration that I believe the Lord gave me, and I hope it'll connect it all together. Now, some of you might find this funny depending on where you're from. Some of you might not. I was talking to a young man. I'll be a little specific. I won't call his name. At the church the other day, and he and I got in a conversation, and we started talking about a particular state, and that state was West Virginia. And in the same sentence he used West Virginia, he used the word heaven. And he reminded me of a license plate that I saw one time when I was in West Virginia. At the top of this license plate, it had West Virginia. And at the bottom, it had almost heaven. And I thought about that, knowing what I was getting ready to preach this morning. I said to that young man, I said, boy, West Virginia is a poor substitute for heaven. If West Virginia is almost, even almost heaven, I don't want to go. But watch this, and I'm looking at him right now. I love West Virginia, and God have allowed me to meet some great people in West Virginia and from West Virginia, one of them right there, amen. But watch this. Now, if West Virginia is a poor substitute for heaven, how much more is anything or anybody else a poor substitute for the Lord Jesus Christ when it comes to worship? Would you bow your heads with me for a word of prayer? Lord Jesus, I do thank you for this time, and thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity that you've given us to gather around thy holy and precious word. And Lord, I do pray and ask you to help us, Lord. Strengthen, Lord God, my commitment. Strengthen my desire, Lord God, to be a true worshiper of thee. And Lord, give me the boldness and courage, Lord God, that I need to cry out in thy word, Lord God, against the idolatry that's going on in our day. God, help this thy people, Lord. Strengthen us individually and collectively, Lord God, in our desire to be, Lord, true worshipers of thee. And help us to not be ashamed, but to boldly cry out against idol worship in our day. Lord, we do praise you and thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. Brother Polly.
Amen. Amen. Powerful. Now, I want you to look at me for just a moment, all right? We cry out about everybody else's false religion, but what about our own? So you got to judge yourself first. Now look me in the face, please. You could have a certain idea about man in your own heart that would keep you from being a true worshiper of God. You could have your own ideas about what ought to happen in a service. You could have your own desire for certain emotions even, and let that substitute for truly worshiping God. And judge yourself. Then God will give you the discernment to help deal with others. Now, this is a great message and extremely, extremely helpful. And I appreciate it. I was with him to the last illustration. He lost me there. The only thing I hate in this message is that Brother Otis is not going to heaven when he dies. And it's just bad. It's really bad. Sorry. That was a good message. The Lord used him. As much as I love West Virginia, I know heaven's going to be much, much better. The best part of heaven's going to be where all the people from West Virginia live. But yes. You let the preacher know this was a blessing today, and we appreciate him. I greet our guests, our visitors. Now, I need you to listen to two things, all right? The Teens for Christ crusade tonight, I want you to be there if you're not working. And I don't just want you to come. I want you to try to bring a teenager with you. Look. Today could be heaven or hell for somebody. So you go find a young person today. Some of you work with kids on bus routes and in Bible clubs. Make an effort. Go the second mile today. Round them up. Get them there tonight. Bob Holmes will do a program from about 5 to about 6:15, 6:20 in the gymnasium at Central High School. So if you want to see all of that, the one-man volleyball team and all of that program, you need to be there between that time. The rally, the preaching rally, begins at 6:30. And we got a lot of special things planned. It's going to be a great night, and I want to encourage you to be there. Some of you have a special burden for young people. How many of you, that's really what's in your heart, working with young people, all right? I have a youth ministry class that meets at noon today in room 134. That's in the hymn writer's hallway. And Brother Holmes is going to be in it today, and he's going to talk about lots of things kids are dealing with, from bullying to suicide, lots of things that he sees in schools. And if you don't have a noon class and you'd like to come, you don't have to be in that class to be there today. Room 134 at noon, you're welcome to come. And if you'd just like to sit in and listen, that would be great. Now, I need you to take this sheet out, if you will, please. And I'd like to get to two or three men and ladies here at the exit. And if you will hand these in as you leave the chapel hour on your way to the next class today, I would greatly appreciate it. If some of you still need to make a phone call, work out some details, get a little information to put on this, then don't turn it in yet, but you must turn it in by Monday. You have the weekend if you need to get a little more information, all right? If you have it completed, turn that in today, and we sure appreciate it. Brother Otis, thank you for preaching to us today. God used you. Thank you so much. Have a great afternoon.